Burn me righteous, burn me holy, burn me beautiful. with your name. Brand us with your name. Marked forever.
Okay, good evening. Sorry, We're having technical difficulties, but that's usually the way it is when God's about to do something big. The enemy really tries to mess scripture before we get into the word. John 10, sheep. All who have come before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep have not listened to them. I am the gate. Whoever enters through me will be saved. They will come in and go out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I have come so that they may have life and have life more abundantly. I just want to let Pastor Pawpaw know how grateful I am for his word and how much it's delivered me and how much I've learned and how anointed it is and how, because when deliverance is being spoken and lives are being saved and chains are being broken, the enemy will attack you and he will tell you, you shouldn't be up here. You're not doing anything. But no, God said no. God set you apart and you are supposed to be up here and you are saving so many lives and speaking so many truths. And I am so thankful and I have been so blessed by it. And I feel like we all have. And it's such an honor and a blessing to just have you here and speaking God's word. And I look forward to it every time I know you're coming up here. It's always going to be good. So I just want to pray for you before we get into the word. Let's see if this is on. Nope. Before we get into the word, let's pray for our pastor before he brings forth the word. Father God, I just pray your anointing over Papa, over Pastor David Matthews Sr., Lord. I thank you for the words that you've given him to speak. I thank you that he listens. He is your servant, and he speaks only for you. I thank you, Lord, that we receive truth from the words that he speaks and deliverance, and that we can feel your presence and that he's a humble man who will bow down and worship you, Lord. And I pray that we can look up to him and learn from him, Lord. Just bless his body, mind, soul, spirit, and his wife, and I pray your wisdom and your anointing as he brings forth your word tonight. Let chains be broken and lives be saved. And thank you so much for your servant who's serving you so humbly and so eagerly. Thank you so much for him, Lord. Please bless this word and the short worship we're about to have. In your beautiful name I pray. Amen.
Sick and without your help, he will not last. Mary and Martha watched their brother die. They waited for Jesus, he did not come, and they wonder why. The death watch was over. Thank you. there 4 days. The gravestone was rolled back. Then Jesus cried, Lazarus, come forth. Then somebody said, he's alive, he's alive.
Supply there. this water. Sing it, there is a vast. There is a
want to talk about that river a little bit here tonight. It was promised and it was given, wasn't it? Before the Lord ever went away, He said, I need you to go into all the world and preach this gospel. Basically told him, but you won't have to do it alone. So don't run out and do this until you first go to the upper room and tarry until you be filled with what I'm going to be sending back, the precious gift of the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And he said, this will give you the strength, this will give you the power, this will give you the guidance to accomplish what I've called you to do. And that generation that obeyed that word is the first and the only generation that has reached its generation for the Lord. The Bible records, as I mentioned before, when Paul was going to enter one town, they looked up and the scripture says, he that turned the rest of the world upside down has come to our towns. Batten the hatches, lock the doors. They accredit the Apostle Paul with several things. One of them, he being so full of the Lord, God was able to use him to write almost half of the New Testament. That's a lot of confidence in someone. But some accuse him of even inventing Christianity. Of course, that's the world looking from the outside. The Apostle Paul, so full of the Holy Spirit, is accused of having much to do with bringing down the great Roman Empire, what the greatest one on the earth at that time, because of the presence of God in that little man. That's why I wanted to touch on a little bit tonight the importance and the need of the gift of the baptism of the Holy Spirit. There was a young man that got saved one time, and he was so excited. It was that first love that was birthed and born, and he was just full and overflowing with the presence of Christ. And when he went back the next week, he talked to the old preacher and said, pastor said, I got saved and it's so wonderful. He said, do you really think I need the baptism of the Holy Ghost to go to heaven? He looked at him and said, son, go to heaven. He said, I wouldn't want to go to the post office without it. How much that it is needed. One very important reason that born-again believers need to ask and seek until they receive that gift of the baptism is because of the desires has come to bring the mind of God to us and let us know what His thoughts are and what His desires are for us and those round about us. And therefore, in the church, in the body of Christ, because we as individuals come together and make up that body, the church, which He said is His body, the body of Christ. In fact, in many ways, it's as important for a born-again believer to be filled with that gift of the baptism as it is for the sinner to be born again. If we as individuals in the church collectively are going to do all that God has called us to do, it is going to take a power beyond the natural ability of man. From the garden, we can see what man is able to produce, and it always ends in a disaster. When he leaves the ways and the plans of God, God had laid out in that garden everything that they could live forever. But when they decided to do their things their way, it all crumbled. In Matthew 28:19, it says, "Go ye therefore and teach all nations all things whatsoever I have commanded." But He did not want them to even start or to attempt to do that until first He told them in Luke 24:49, "And behold, I send the promise of My Father upon you, but tarry ye in the city of Jerusalem until you be endued with power from on high." Even Jesus Himself never began His public ministry until in Matthew 3:16 it says, "And Jesus, when He was baptized, went up straightway out of the water, and lo, the heavens were opened unto Him." That's what it does. "And He saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and lighting upon Him. And lo, a voice from heaven saying, This is My beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." With all that happened, God was well pleased. That Spirit, the Holy Spirit, descended upon Him and it stayed. Now Jesus is fully equipped. Now He's ready to begin His public ministry. It's after that happened that He then started to make His way to reach those round about. Then immediately you go right into Matthew 4, and it says that Jesus was then led by the Spirit. And always after that, you find it recorded in John 5:30, "I can of my, I seek not mine own will," because there was something had come from above that was going to do the directing, "but the will of the Father which has sent me." And John 5:19, "Then answered Jesus and said unto them, Verily, verily," something very important, "I say unto you, the Son can do nothing of Himself, but what He seeth the Father do. For what things soever He doeth, the Son doeth likewise." John 8:28, a portion of it says, "I do nothing of Myself, but as My Father had the Holy Spirit." Jesus is filled with and led by that Holy Spirit. If it was important for Him, how much more is it important for us? Then God tells us in Philippians 2:5, "When this has happened, now let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus." This is what led Him. This is what directed Him. This is what gave Him the power. When we move further into that church age, we find God telling the Corinthian church in 1 Corinthians 2:4, "And My speech and My preaching was not with the enticing words of man's wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power, that your faith should not stand in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God. But as it is written, I have not seen nor ear heard, neither have entered into the heart of man, the things which God has prepared for them that love Him. But God had revealed them unto us by his Spirit. If you want to know where he's going and what he wants done and how he wants it done, he does it through the leading of his Spirit. For the Spirit searcheth all things. It's God. He's not going to miss nothing. Yea, it says the deep things of God. Don't stay in the shallows where the tadpoles and the logs wash up on the bank of that river. It speaks of that river that there's an ankle deep, there's a knee deep, there's a loin deep, and there's a swimming. Get out away from the tadpoles and the water moccasins and the logs. Move on out to knee deep. Get into the loin deep. Get out in the middle of it where you swim so far you can't see the bank to get back. And the only way out is on up to glory. For what man knoweth the things of man save the spirit of man? That's the natural. Even so the things of God knoweth no man but the Spirit of God. He knows the things of God. And that's what he's come to direct us in all the ways of God. In 1 Corinthians 2:12, he goes on and says, now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit which is of God, that we might know the things that are freely given to us by God. That's how you get to them. That's how you know them. Which things also we speak, not in the words which man's wisdom teaches, but which the Holy Ghost teacheth, comparing spiritual things with spiritual things. We got to get above this rotten world. God has some things he wants to say to us that we can come back and have an impact upon this earth. But the natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God. That flesh doesn't want to go there. It doesn't want to be a part. It says, for they are foolishness unto that natural man, neither can without the leading of that Holy Spirit. God has given the gift of the baptism of the Holy Spirit so that we can know the will, the thoughts, the desires, the direction to have to bring the mind of God, what he would have us to do. This is why he told those first disciples, do not go any place, anything, until you first tarry in that prayer meeting, until you're filled with this gift that I'm going to send. Jesus also said, and this promise of the Holy Spirit is also unto you and to your children and to all that are far off, as many as the Lord our God shall call. I can tell you, if he's still calling and saving, he's still filling. He didn't die with that last disciple. God is eternal. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. To make a little more plain and simple, God said in Romans 8:14, for as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. Why is it so important that we have and know the mind of God through the baptism of the Holy Spirit? Because there's only one other option, and that's to be led and by the flesh, by the natural man. And God warns in Romans 8:7, the carnal mind, or our natural mind, in our own thinking, in our own thoughts, is enmity against God. It will do the exact wrong thing and opposite thing if we're led by our natural mind. For it is not subject to the law of God, it says in Romans 8:7. Neither indeed can be. And that it is not a very good recommendation or choice. Adam and Eve tried that. It didn't work out very good, did it? But in Romans 8:16 says, the Spirit itself beareth witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. Likewise, the Spirit also helpeth our infirmities. You got problems? It doesn't matter what it is. God has the answer. For we know not what we should pray for as we ought. Have you ever been there? You're in the middle of a situation, can't hardly tell what's up, what's down, what's sideways. We just don't know which way to go. But he said, but the Spirit itself maketh intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. Oh, it can flow out. It can pray. It knows the answer. It knows the path of God. It knows what the answer is. Romans 8:27, and he that searcheth the hearts knoweth what is the mind of the Spirit, because he maketh intercession for the saints according to the will of God. To ever fulfill and do the work of God, we must know and have that mind and direction of that Holy Spirit. And that can only happen, be given by the Spirit of the living God. But if I can think the thoughts of God, then I can do the work of God. Because it's his work. He knows how he wants it done, when and where and how. Because whether it's in the natural or the supernatural, all ability is of that mind. In the natural earthly, whatever we learn must pass through that mind before we can learn it, or whatever it is. In the supernatural world, the world of God, it is through and by the Spirit that we learn and obtain spiritual knowledge. That's what we just read earlier, wasn't it? This is why God tells us, Ephesians 5:18, be filled with the Spirit. Do I want a radio on my car? Do I want air conditioner or not? To be filled with the Spirit isn't a suggestion for us to look at it and see how what we think about it and how we feel about it. That little word, be filled, is present tense. That does not mean 20 years ago. It doesn't mean 5 years in the future. Be filled means right now, right here, every second, every breath of our life, to be filled. An earthly example is of that. When your pastor was a little boy growing up, and my daughter, just about the same size, we used to make sure we go to church, they're going to church. They're going to be right there. They're not going to be up running the walls. They're going to sit there. You have to teach them. There is times. There is places. There is reasons. Sometimes that they have to sit still and be quiet. Mama, they always tried to get away from Dad. But my dad's long arm, I could reach around Mom and give him a little tap and say, be still. Now, when I said that, I didn't mean be still last week or be still sometimes next month. When I said be still, I meant be still right then. So when God says be filled, he means now. He means every second, every breath. To see the importance of be filled, and even an instant in season and out of season, in Matthew chapter 25, if you would like to turn there. Matthew 25, and begin reading at verse 1. It says, then shall the kingdom of heaven. We're talking about you need to be filled at all times. Then the kingdom of heaven be likened unto 10 virgins. And you need to note, it didn't say 5 virgins and 5 bank robbers. He didn't say 5 virgins and 5 harlots. He said 10 virgins, which took their lamps and went forth to meet the bridegroom. We're all doing that, aren't we? Trying our very best. And 5 of them were wise, and 5 of them were foolish. Some were not ladies of the night and the other good girls. They were all good girls. They that were foolish took their lamps and took no oil with them. But the wise took oil in their vessels with their lamps. While the bridegroom tarried, just like he's doing now, you do know we make up the bride of Christ, which is the church. He is the bridegroom. He's coming back for his bride. We're going to have a marriage supper of the Lamb one day, but that's another sermon. We don't want to go there. It's a good one. While the bridegroom tarried, they all slumbered and slept. And at midnight, he said, in an hour when you think not, he said, I'm coming. And at midnight there was a cry made, behold, the bridegroom cometh, go ye out to meet him. In the moment, in the twinkling of an eye, then all those virgins arose and trimmed their lamps. And the foolish said unto the wise, give us of your oil, for our lamps are gone out. But the wise answered, saying, not so, lest there be not enough for us and you. But go ye rather to them that sell, and buy for yourselves. Every Christian is going to reach the place where they can no longer depend on the husband. They can no longer depend on the wife. They can no longer depend on mom and dad. You reach a place in God. He has no grandchildren, only children. Just because I preached the gospel, that didn't mean my son was automatically going to do it. He had to seek God for himself and get close to him and obey his calling that God had touched his life. Just because mama saved doesn't mean that automatically saved the kids. When that kid reached that age of accountability, they've got to go to the Lord for themselves. And that's what it's saying here. It's not that they were selfish. Every person must seek out their own salvation with fear and trembling. And while they went to buy, the bridegroom came, and they that were ready went in with him to the marriage, and the door was shut. Afterward came also the other virgin, saying, Lord, Lord, open unto us. But he answered and said, verily I say unto you, I know you not. Watch therefore, for you know neither the day nor the hour wherein the Son of Man cometh. Be filled at all filled with the Spirit is to be willing to listen and to obey the Holy Spirit. Just because he's come, there is that mind of God that's come by the Holy Ghost to direct us. But we also have our natural mind. And just because the Lord wants us to go one direction, that doesn't mean I can be rebellious and go another and decide I know best. Always be led and listen to that Spirit. There was a good friend of mine one time that was building a great church. And to have enough to build that church, he sold what they call bonds. And when you buy those bonds, you make a certain amount of interest. And so over that period of time, he was thinking he would be able to, that money would be raised so when that it came due, he would be able to pay the people back their money. But that Sunday came, and the deadline was up, and the money was going to be due for those bonds at the bank that those people had loaned him that money. And he liked a quarter having 50 cents. He didn't have it. It didn't work out. He didn't do nothing wrong. He pressed on. He worked hard. But when the deadline come, if some reason it just didn't work out. And there he is late Sunday night after that service, walking in that sanctuary, praying and crying out to God, Lord, what am I going to do? In the morning, they're going to be there wanting their money, and I don't have it. And he kept knocking on heaven's door until about 1:30 in the morning. He had cried out to God so much, he'd about lost his voice and just give out, and was just sitting up against the wall, just sitting there. And all of a sudden, there was a voice that said, there's somebody I can talk to. He said he threw up his hands. He about run around that sanctuary thanking God. He said, Lord, will please talk to him. He had the victory. He went home. He was taking that shower, getting ready for bed. And he told the wife, he said, I got the victory. Amen. He took his shower. He went to bed about 2:30 then. 4:30. He woke her up. She looked over. He's getting ready. She said, where are you going? He said, I'm going back to them altars of the sanctuary. I got to pray. She said, I thought you had the victory. He said, I thought I did too. But he had someone. And as he was praying, He sensed there was somebody looking at him. He said, and he opened his eyes, and there was a woman a few feet away from his face looking right at him. And when he opened his eyes, he said it scared him. He said he thought he was the only one in that sanctuary. He said, yes, ma'am. And she said, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to scare you. He said, that's all right. How can I help you? She said, I got a donation for the church, and I come by to give it. Well, he was on radio and television and that all over the place, and people would come by with $10 and $20 and want to help him. Said, yes, ma'am, we need help, and I appreciate it. Said, the secretary will be here at 8 o'clock. Said, I don't want to see the secretary. Said, God woke me up at 1 o'clock this morning and said, bring this to you. And said he owed $38,000, set $43,000 down on that altar, and said, God woke me up 1 o'clock. The same time God said, there's somebody I can talk to. And she bought it $5,000 more than he needed to pay that $38,000 debt. It's good to listen to the Lord. When he says he bought the victory, thank him for it. But when you feel like it's gone, listen to him anyway. God had to wake him up. He had to disturb that peace of that sleep to get him back to that altar, because God had an appointment. He'd called that woman and told her, you bring that man of God that. And he went back. He obeyed that, even though he lost the victory, he thought. But God knew what he was doing. His ways are above our ways. In Matthew 4:1 said, Jesus was led by the Spirit, not forced or driven. Romans 4:8-14 says, as many as are led by the Spirit, they are the sons of God. Led by, not forced, not driven. Because even though we may be filled with the Spirit, we still have a free will. We still have an earthly mind. We have to decide, am I going God's way or am I going my way? Can that really happen? Well, look at Jonah. God said, go to Nineveh. Jonah said, I'd rather go to Tarshish. So he went to Joppa and caught a boat headed to Tarshish. God told him where to go, but he didn't want to go where God said. You know the story. You know how that worked out for Jonah, don't you? Got thrown over the side. He was a troubler. And God had that big fish prepared. Swallowed him in that whale's belly for 3 days and 3 nights. And I want to tell you, in that stomach of that whale, those acids that break down that food, 3 days he'd been eating half his shirt off, part of his shoes probably. And that whale, the Eskimos knows that whale Megak, that's threw up, just vomited him up on that shore. He lands out and all that slime, seaweed hanging off his ear. But I can tell you this, he said, God, I'm going. It's always best to listen to God the first time. I want to share something interesting about that mind. He said, if that sinner will repent, I will save him. God set that forth. Whether it has to do with the natural or with the supernatural, that principle is all ability comes from and through the mind, whether it's the natural or the supernatural. First, let us consider that natural, fleshly mind. In a negative way, if something goes haywire in that natural mind, in that brain, like Alzheimer's may hit, can reach a person, and he can bring him to the place, because that mind is one haywire that he can't even tie shoes or feed himself. A person can have a stroke and that blood cut off to that mind, and part of it dies and part of his body can die, his face, his speech, because that mind, that brain has been affected. A person can fall and hit his head in a right way and it can affect that brain. I thought I'd kill the state overseer one time. I bought him overseer's feet, shot out from under him, and he landed right on his head. Thank the Lord he had a cap on. It helped a little bit, but it jarred that brain so much as I was helping him up. He started talking to me and telling me things, but what he didn't know, it was nothing but gibberish. What he was trying to say, it wasn't coming out. For that little bit of time, it affected that brain and that mind. The ability of that mind is so powerful, it can sometimes even shape the features. But as they hang on those cages, their features are twisted and torn, simply because not of physically in the body, but because that mind has been affected. In the book of Daniel chapter 4, verse 3, it talks about a man that got filled with pride. His name was Nebuchadnezzar. He got lifted up. He thought he was high and mighty and had it all. And it caused him to become like an animal when God, oxen and cows and horses. He lived out in that field like an animal until his hair began to grow. And the Bible says, as long as eagle feathers. That mind had been touched. The nails grew like the claws of an eagle or a vulture or a bird. God had touched that mind, and that's what happened. But over a period of time, after he was in this state for quite a while, God reached down, he touched that mind again. And when God turned him loose this time, he said, "The heavens do rule." He knew that there was a power above his and above his might that was greater than his. And he said, "The heavens do rule." But to the positive side concerning the ability that comes from the mind, in our natural world, at one time, automobiles was just a thought in a man's mind. There wasn't any in one period of history. But because that mind could think that, eventually we're driving around in them today, aren't we? The mind of an artist can paint, not because of the hand is talented. Some people may think that, well, he's a painter because his hand is able to do certain things. But painters don't have different hands than what I got. They don't have seven fingers on one hand, and so it gives them a special ability. Their arm's not shaped different from mine, and they're able to do the canvas and the brush a certain way that I can't do. The difference is in the mind. How do I know? Because they've shown people. You can see it. It's recorded. People that have no hands, they can paint with their feet, with their toes, beautiful portraits. They have people that have special things made to put in their mouth. And though they don't have the arms, they can paint beautiful portraits with their teeth. How come? Because the ability isn't just in the hand or the arm. The ability comes from that mind. There's people that play that piano. If I get on that, it'd run everybody out. But there's people get on there and make beautiful music with it. The difference isn't because they got a different kind of hand or more hands or different kind of arms. We have the same. The difference is the ability of the mind. All them basketball players that do their protesting and say how awful America is while they're making $1 million a week. Their arm isn't any different than mine. There was a time I could throw that basketball about as far as they can, but I couldn't pop that net like that three-pointer, whatever his name is. I don't keep up with all the people that run my country. The ability is that mind has trained that it can calculate that distance and the power that it takes to that arm. And that's how they pop that net. It's not because they got a different kind of arm or hand. The mind is what is able to do that. Many years ago, the power of that mind, before man ever knew what a rocket was, they used to have a series called Buck Rogers. And probably most of you've never heard of that. But what Buck Rogers was many years ago, it was a story that talked about rockets and going to the moon. Nobody had never heard of it. It was just something made up. But man began to think that, and they began to see it, until one day there was a rocket and man did walk on that moon. That ability that can come out of that human mind is staggering. That machine that they put on the moon, I mentioned it here a while back, it wasn't about as big as a shoebox. Cost $50 million, went to the moon with them. A man sat on Earth at NASA and talked to that machine. And he was told him to look for life on that moon. And so one of them gave the command for that machine to reach out and get some dirt. That machine signaled back and said, there's a pin in the arm. You got to pull it so I can reach out that shovel. And so that machine removed that pin. That shovel went out, dug that dirt, pulled it back in, analyzed it, said there ain't no worms up here. Ain't no life on that moon. Man's ability, that mind, the ability, there must be something to it, because God talked about some people in Genesis chapter 11. And the Lord came down to see the city and the tower which the children of men builded. And Genesis 11 and 6, and the Lord said, behold, the people is one, and they have all one language, and this they begin to do. And now nothing will be restrained from them which they have imagined to do. But as amazing as the ability of that earthly and fleshly carnal mind is, it does have its limitation. But the mind of God has no limitation. God is omniscient, an unmeasurable mind and knowledge. God knows everything. And God is omnipotent. He is almighty. He is all power. He doesn't have some might or some power. He has all might and all power. And Luke 1:37 says, for with God nothing shall be impossible. That's why God tells us in 2 Corinthians 10 and 5, casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalted itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. One of the very important reasons that every born-again believer needs to ask and receive the gift of the baptism and then stay full at all times is because the Holy Spirit is a facility and means through which we communicate with God, and He with us, which is very important, so that we can know the thoughts, desires, and the mind of God. Because it's through that mind coming by the Holy Spirit that come all ability, and that's where all possibilities come from with God. And it is by and through the Holy Spirit that the heavens are opened up and we're cabled directly to the throne of God. We may ask, like the early disciples, how can these things be? And the answer is still the same today as it was then. There may be many things impossible with man, but Jesus said, with me, all things are possible. God has told us that in the last days, knowledge would increase. It's been a while since I've looked at the statistics. But at one time, they said that about 90% of all scientists that have ever been and lived are living today on this earth. And that for many, many years, it took 75 years for knowledge to double. But now, in our time, knowledge is doubling every 18 months. It's staggering. That's amazing. Man has expanded the ability of that mind. That's why you go by that cell phone today, at about a month up the road, it's done obsolete. Knowledge increasing. But sooner or later, the human, natural mind, it does have its limitation. There are thoughts and ability that he will never be able to obtain. If you turn to Isaiah chapter 55 And in Romans 11:33, it points out the reason we must have the Holy Spirit to lead us. In Isaiah 55:8-9, it says, God tells us, "For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways, saith the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts." There's just some things never gonna get to without the power and infilling of the Holy Spirit. But through the power of the Holy Spirit bringing to us the thoughts, the will, the desires, the mind, the abilities of God, all things do become possible through Him, because there's no human mind that can conceive or much less have the ability to part a Red Sea. In our natural mind, we couldn't ever figure that out and couldn't accomplish that. Or to stop a universe that this Bible records. I can tell you, when Moses stood at that Red Sea, there was no book that had been written 10 steps to parting seas and parting oceans. There was none written. When Joshua was in the middle of that battle, there was no book written on 5 ways to stop the sun from going down and how to park a universe. They hadn't been written. Sometimes the greatest transition is from the seen to the unseen. We have problems getting there within ourselves, but the Holy Spirit can take us there. From the natural to the supernatural, from unbelief to believing, from the human to the divine. Because sometimes the biggest hindrance to God working His wonders among us on this earth is limited when we get our carnal mind into the play. But God gave us the answer on the day of Pentecost, the outpouring of the Holy Ghost. And when He did, Peter jumped straight up and said, "This is that." He knew what had come. He had read of it. He had heard of it. He had hoped for it. But all of a sudden, it filled his innermost being. And when it hit bottom and come back up, he was speaking in a heavenly language. And with that outpouring, the heavens opened up, cabled him directly to the throne of God, with the power as he walked by his shadow would make sick people well. For anybody to say that the day of miracles is over is to say that God has died. But there's never been a day of miracles. There's always only been a God of miracles. That very same Holy Spirit outpouring that saved 3,000 in a day is still the same today as it was yesterday. There's some today that would say, maybe we're preaching God too big, but that's exactly the problem. We preached Him too little, because there's nothing impossible with our God. How do I know? Because I have history, the record, the facts, and the witness of the Holy Spirit. Because I'm talking about the one that broke the back of the most powerful nation in the world at that time. That Egyptian people that had his people as slaves. One breath, one move, one night set 3 million people free. That's what they figure. From 1 to 3 million come out of Egypt. Got to the Red Sea in front of them. A mountain on both sides. Pharaoh's army closing in behind them. And the devil said, "You're going to die." But one man, not an angel, not a seraphim, not a cherubim, one man by the Spirit of God heard the mind of God, and he stood up, stretched out a stick over the Red Sea and rolled it back and made it stand up at attention at the power and the presence of a God that can do anything. Anybody that may have watched that Cecil B. DeMille's Ten Commandments, in that picture, they may have got the wrong impression, because as you see it on the screen, it looked like that Red Sea may have opened up about 100 yards, you know, about as long as this building is. But there may have been about 3 million people come out of Egypt. And the Word of God says every one of them passed through that Red Sea in one night. 3 million people. A rough calculation of that shows that God, it was, knew the mind of God and with a stick parted that sea. He sweetened the bitter waters of Moriah. For 14,600 days, he kicked over angels' tables and dumped 640 boxcar loads of manna in the right spot to feed them every single day. A rock followed them every place they went, pouring out, gave them clothes that never wore out, gave them shoes that grew with their feet, put central air and heat in a desert for 40 years. If not, they would have burned up in the day and froze at night. But he gave them a cloud by day and a fire by night. The only one that could central heat and cool a desert is God. Others parked the sun and halted a universe, rolled back the Jordan, pushed over walls of Jericho, brought down fire from heaven, made the sun move backwards, made iron to swim, raised the dead, stopped armies, closed the mouth of lions, gave sight to the blind, made the dumb to speak, caused the lame to walk and leap and run, calmed stormy seas, walked on water, fed thousands with a bag lunch of a boy, cast out devils, made the insane sane, made a withered hand grow from nothing, the shadow of a preacher making people whole as he walked down the street. And like Samson, howbeit, when the hair of his head began to grow, and with a brand new consecration to God cried, "Oh God, do it just one more time. God, do it one more time. Rend the heavens and come down among us. Show us your glory, Lord, your power and your majesty. He is well able. All he needs to do is find somebody that does thirst and hunger after righteousness. That's our part. All we have to do is hunger and thirst." God said, "I'll do the filling. I'll pour it out. I can bring the power. I can bring the way. I can bring the answer. The Lord, he is God." How he wants to walk among us in his freedom as we yield, saying, "Lord, just do it one more time." Oh, we're needy. We're thirsty. We look at the conditions of the world. There's but one answer. That's for people that would dare to come and pray and ask him one more time. Let him touch our lives and bring us to the place where we can be an open vessel, ready for him to pour in the gift of that baptism afresh and anew, where the oil may have leaked down. And sometimes that's part of the problems. You see, those 10 virgins, they were all had the oil at one time. But you use that oil up of the Holy Spirit as you walk through. You got to stay at the fountain. Let it continue to flow and continually be filled. Not back 10 years ago, not 5 years up the road, but to flow today continually and not to run out. Because the oil in that lamp is important. In the old days, they had what they call coal oil lamps. And as long as you kept that coal oil in there and it was burning, had the oil, it gave a good light. But if that oil ever burnt down and it began to burn only on that wick, that black smut would just smut the mantle. It smut that glass. And sometimes that's what's happened in these times. Christians have run out of that oil, and they're just running on the flesh. And all it does is smart the eye, the smoke that comes out of it. But to be refilled, that we're burning on the oil of the Holy Spirit one more time, that is what will lift up and glorify the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's what they're looking for. The cry is the same. We would see Jesus. And that's what happened when they come out of that upper room and was filled. They took note they had been with Jesus. They seen the same power and presence. They thought they had crucified him, done away with him, would have a problem no more. And now here Jesus was starting to spring up everywhere. They took note. They're acting just like they're doing the same thing. They're healing people. God is touching We thought we'd got rid of him. Here he is springing up everywhere. That's what God desires in these days, to come back to the fountain. We sang that song tonight. There is a river that flows from the throne of God. That's where you got to get it. You got to come to that throne. That river flows from there, and it can flow to fill our innermost being. And that's what the scripture's talking about, that out of our belly should flow a river. The healing power of that Holy Spirit, making Christ real, healing, touching, saving, filling everything that it touches. Oh, yes. He's been preached too little. God is still able to do it, and he's going to do it. That same church that was birthed on the day of Pentecost, he's going to bring it back. Bring back the altar. Bring back the prayer. Bring back to those that do thirst and hunger. And he's going to pour it out just as he did in that upper room that day when they walked out and startled the world. They thought he was dead, but he was resurrected, living. And those that were there to seek him until he rained righteousness down one more time. Oh, I long for those days. I want to see that before I check out. I want to see that great outpouring, and I believe we're very near. I believe we're getting very near. God always waits to the darkest hour when the devil has thrown everything at people and the earth and situations that he can, where it looks like there's no hope. Then God walks on the scene. Then he comes down. It was the darkest hour in Egypt. But God heard their cry, he seen their tears, and he bought them out and safe. He can do the same. He never changes. He never changes. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. They cried, they prayed, God heard, God delivered. We call out to him today. He can do the same thing. They weren't anymore a special human being that we are. They just cried out, and God heard the cry, and he seen the tears. Lord, help us that we may seek his face until one more time he rained righteousness down upon us and through us. I believe I want to seek him tonight and get one prayer closer. One prayer closer to seeing this happen. One prayer closer to see a renewed outpouring of this power and this power and this glory and this presence of God. And when you walk in the place, you can feel his presence. Glory to his name. Lord, do it one more time. Lord, do it one more time. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I'm going to come tonight and seek him for a while. And anybody out there that was listening, make an altar right where you are. And he will heal your prayer. You can believe with us, and we're going to believe with you for a mighty outpouring of the presence of God. The elderly Eskimo man that come to me this morning, he talked about one that seen a vision of a great fire over this North Slope borough. The fiery presence of the Holy Spirit that's going to be poured out. And I totally agreed with him. I said, I believe it's going to happen. I believe it's coming. There's going to be an outpouring that's going to shake this North Slope borough, spread through Alaska, across the United States, and affect this entire world. Our vision got too small. We just think about our little world sometimes. But God so loved the what? The world. The world. He had a world vision. He's that big. He holds it all in the palm of his hand. It's not too hard for him. It's not an impossibility. God is able. All we got to do is stay and knock on that door like that widow woman that like to drove that judge crazy. She come back every day. She had a need, knocking on that judge's door. He'd send her away, come back the next day. God said that should be his people. She stayed until that judge said, please give her what she wants so she will leave me alone. Knock on that door long enough. God sees we mean business. He's going to open it. No man can shut it. And he's going to hear that heart's cry. Those that would like to come with me tonight, and that's talk to him. Ask him one more time. And those out there, ask him. That's believe together for God to rend the heavens and come down one more time. God bless you. Thank you, Jesus.
I've wasted many, many precious years, but now I'm coming home. I now repent.
Yeah. Thank you. So
with your name, marked forever with your signature. You sing that one more time. Burn me beautiful. Burn me beautiful. Burn me lovely. Burn me righteous. Burn me holy. Burn me beautiful. Burn me lovely. Burn me righteous. Burn me holy. One more time. Burn me beautiful. Burn me lovely. Burn me righteous. Burn me holy. Burn me beautiful. Burn me lovely. Burn me righteous. Burn me holy. You're a fire, the refiner. I wanna be consumed. You're a fire, the refiner. I wanna be consumed. You're a fire. I just want you.
of a midnight hour. When I'm alone in my room, if I'm going under, oh, I just can't explain. No, but it brings me back to life. It's like the sound of a newborn baby crying. Yeah, like the final breath of a loved one passing. It's a beautiful thing, yeah, 'cause it leads me to the light. It's like a drive-through movie, small town with the big screen, like grilling out in the front yard. Sometimes it's the simple things, like storytelling with my grandpa. He was so easy to believe, like when the sun goes up, yeah. Sometimes it's better when the sun comes down. The moonlight, and it can make you feel alright. Oh, it's the voice of God, and it can make a grown man cry. Yet again, yet again, it's the voice of God. It can make a grown man cry.
Still small voice, the voice of God. Everything responds when he calls. Everything responds when he speaks. I come alive when he calls.